It's in love. church, Lord, make us strong, Lord. Join our hearts, Lord, through your Son. Make us one, Lord, in your body, in the kingdom of your Son. You are
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
I do?
Yes.
Glory to God, I just was worshiping, worshiping. I can't get there. Precious. Hallelujah. Thank y'all for not giving up on Jeremiah. Tanya almost ends up every week.
No, she doesn't.
Yeah, she does. She's had enough.
Didn't you have to give up on Nehemiah and Ezra?
And then Ezekiel. She's ready for us to party.
Yes, I'm
glory
ready.
Glory to God, we're still pushing through. Zaya likes to party.
Yes, victory. Victory.
Hallelujah. Well, now, so we got where we're doing chapters 28 and 29. I was also glad when I saw there was only 17 verses in chapter 28. I said, Lord, we can knock this thing out. Okay, so the first chapter is about the yoke of iron. Jeremiah had warned Judah about the false prophets and the false priest, and, you know, everything was a mess. Everything was corrupt in Judah and Jerusalem. Yeah, just right where we are right now. Everything is corrupt. Y'all saw this morning that that woman that's trying out for the Olympics and won something, and oh, she's so offended by the national anthem that she can't, if she wins, she can't have it played. They're talking about taking her off the team, and I hope they do. I pray they take her off the team. If they do, of course, there'll be a big political hoorah about it, but that's what she's trying to start anyway. Okay, so one of these prophets is Hananiah. And he, in this chapter, he breaks the yoke of the Lord that the Lord required Jeremiah to wear. It was a wooden yoke. And the Lord had required it of Jeremiah as a sign to the kings of the nations. You remember? He was ordered to do it by God. And he said, and don't, what was the word he used? Don't diminish your words. You make sure you tell them straight, Jeremiah, just like I told you. They were to come into servitude to Nebuchadnezzar because God had released Nebuchadnezzar as his instrument, as the destroyer. You know, the anointing upon him was the destroyer. So Hananiah broke the yoke with brazen impudence and haughty stubbornness. As a punishment, he died by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah within 2 months of him breaking Jeremiah's yoke. The Lord said, you will die, and he did. This is serious business we're talking about here. Jeremiah summarized the false prophet's words into concise sentences of exactly what they said. You said. They prophesied the situation would be short-lived, and even the religious items taken would be returned in 2 years. But meanwhile, he died in 2 months. Jeremiah said, this is not so. But you go there and you build houses, raise children, plant crops, pray for the peace of the cities of your captivity. Verses 1 through 4 of New King James. Hananiah, the son of Azur the prophet, who was from Gibeon, spoke to me in the house of the Lord. Now he's prophesying lies in the house of the Lord. In the presence of the priest and of all the people, saying, thus speaks the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, saying, I have broken the yoke of the king of Babylon. Within 2 years, I will bring back to this place, and you notice in your notes, this is not written in red, because this is not God talking, this is flesh talking. So he says, within 2 years, I will bring back to this place all the vessels of the Lord's house. But Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, took from this place and carried to Babylon. I will bring back to this place, Jeconiah, and that's that Jehoiakim spelled in a different thing, or that king that Nebuchadnezzar took to Babylon. When all the captives of Judah who went to Babylon, says the Lord, for I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon. Well, this is a false prophecy. This is a false prophecy. So Jeremiah stands back. Now he's prophesying to Jeremiah in the house of the Lord. Jeremiah's there. He's just given his prophecy that they are to submit to Nebuchadnezzar. And so the priests are all there. So this is a big showdown. So Jeremiah pulled back and said sarcastically to Hananiah's false prophecy. Amen. Let it be so. I wish this prophecy to come to pass, but it won't. 7-11. Nevertheless, hear now this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all people. The prophets who have been before me and before you of old prophesied against many countries and great kingdoms of war, disaster, and pestilence. As for the prophet who prophesies of peace, when the word of the prophet comes to pass, the prophet will be known as one whom the Lord has truly sent. Then Hananiah the prophet took the yoke off the prophet Jeremiah's neck and broke it. Hananiah spoke in the presence of all the people, saying, thus says the Lord, even so, I will break the yoke of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, from the neck of all nations within the space of 2 years. And it says the prophet Jeremiah went his way, but he didn't go too far because he turned around almost immediately and gave another word. And those who make the loudest claims to speak for God may have the least right to do so. The truth of a statement must be measured, and not by vehemence with which it is uttered, but the strength of the ground on which it rests. All truth must be grounded in the Word of God. Yesterday I was at River Oaks the Glow, and Ruby gave me a gracious, which is why she brought me over. She says, because of the grounding of the Word of God that is in this ministry and how grounded we are in the Word. And I delivered the message on the Holy Highway, which was those two visions I shared Sunday. And I told them, I said, I don't deliver a vision or a dream unless I can back that dream up with the Word of God. So the same thing is true with your prophecies. It's got to be standing on God's Word and God's way. You may give a foreknowledge that has not been revealed yet, but it will still be in alignment with God's way of operating and how God has spoken in his word. It won't be ever out of alignment with the word of God. So God vindicates Jeremiah and his message. The word of the Lord came quickly. 13 through 17. Go, Jeremiah, go tell Hananiah, saying, the Lord stood up for him. You ever had a God stand up for you? I have. You do it his way and he'll stand up for you.
That's right.
Thus says the Lord, you have broken the yokes of wood, but you have made in their place yokes of iron. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, I have put a yoke of iron on the neck of all these nations, that they may serve Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and they shall serve him. I have given him the beast of the field also. Isn't that amazing? And you know, Jeremiah prophesied that last week, that he gave Nebuchadnezzar the beast of the field. But remember when God judged Nebuchadnezzar, he put him out in the field with the beast. Go get into that. That fascinates me, and I haven't quite study that out. But I'm fascinated by it, so I will study it out when I get time. Then the prophet Jeremiah said to Hananiah the prophet, "Hear now, Hananiah, the Lord has not sent you. The Lord has not sent you. But you make the people trust in a lie. Therefore, says the Lord, behold, I will cast you from off the face of the earth. This year you shall die, because you have taught rebellion against the Lord." So Hananiah, the people died. The prophet died the same year in the same month. Now we can say, well, since Jesus came, this doesn't happen anymore. Oh, well, what about Bar-Jesus and Paul in Acts, I think Acts 13 maybe. And then we can take this to Elijah and the prophets of Baal. God does not change. This is a very serious two chapters here. We make mistakes because we're human and our vessels are in a human vessel. And my faith will believe God for anything, you know. But we have... And God forgives our ignorance, and He forgives our mistakes. Thank goodness, because we see through a glass darkly, and we all don't. None of us know all of it or any of it. That's the reason why God put prophets around us, so that we can, because everyone has gifts to help us out. But if you knowingly speak a lie to manipulate and deceive, I would say that judgment still stands for manipulation.
That's right. That's right.
Because it's deception.
Intentional deception to manipulate and deceive.
That's right.
Iron represents the true word of the Lord and His covenant, which is unyielding and which will not bend. Hananiah couldn't break that yoke. Jeremiah was publicly rebuked. So the Lord publicly rebuked the false prophet. Then and there, he did not wait 6 months and hope for a better forum. He did it right then. He did not hesitate to defy the crowd. And we can compare this, this is my notes, with Paul and with Elijah. Hananiah promised prosperity without true repentance. This is where our prosperity prophets got off. You know, I love the prosperity prophets because they delivered me out of a spirit of poverty, okay, and also a spirit of religion, you know, where I had to give everything away or I couldn't have nice things or whatever. I had a spirit of poverty on me. But I had kind of thought that was holiness, you know. Well, it wasn't. It was not pleasing to God at all. So thank God for the prosperity prophets. But then they got off too far, and they're releasing prosperity without repentance, with no true repentance. And that's a serious matter, and that's one of the ways where they got off. Okay, chapter 29, are about two conflicting letters. Jeremiah writes a letter to the captives in Babylon. Remember, we got Daniel over there serving the Nebuchadnezzar and his son Belshazzar and all those. Daniel's there for a bit. And we got Nehemiah there in Ezra, and they're all in Babylon. God sent them over there. Okay, so he instructed them, the captives who are in Babylon now, to be peaceful and obedient captives in the land of their captivity. And then they would return in 70 years to their homeland. He writes it in the scripture. The Lord had good plans for those whose heart was right toward him. And he still does.
Amen.
They were to pray for the welfare of Babylon. Remember how the Lord rebuked me when I moved to Houston? And I didn't curse I-10, but every time I got on it, I complained about it, and I called it terrible and awful. I wasn't blessing it. The Lord rebuked me. He says, Carolyn, I want you to bless I-10. God sent me into this land, Houston, and he wanted me to bless this land, Houston. You bless the land that you've been sent to.
Amen.
You bless it. You bless this nation. You bless wherever God has put you. I got rebuked.
I did too.
You were fussing about I-10?
Yes, ma'am.
Lord, I bless I-10. If I forgot to bless it lately, I bless it in Jesus' name. And I bless Highway 59 in Jesus' name. And Loop 610.
And that's our
tollway. Huh?
And the West Park tollway.
Well, the West Park tollway hasn't gotten so bad yet. 99's getting not bad, Lord. Not bad. Good, help me with my words, Lord. Yes. But the Lord promises his benevolent purposes for their future welfare and assures them of a ready response when they return, not only to their land, but also to their God. God is doing all of this to get them to return to him. Their finding of God is contingent upon their seeking him with all of their heart. United States of America, we can get our country back from the Satan running it, the Antichrist running it, if you will seek God with your whole heart. Church, we have to seek God with our whole heart.
Yes.
This is when they have no heart left for anything else. And God takes priority over all other interests. Verses 1 through 7, chapter 29. These are the words of the letter that Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem to the remainder of the elders who were carried away captive, to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had carried away captive from Jerusalem to Babylon. This happened after Jeconiah, the king, Queen Mother, the eunuchs, the princes of Judah and Jerusalem, the craftsmen and the smiths had departed from Jerusalem. The letter was sent by the hand of Elisha, the son of Shaphan, and Gemara, the son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to Babylon to Nebuchadnezzar. Now, I find this interesting, too, and there doesn't seem to be any explanation to it. Now, Jeremiah is standing in Zedekiah's face, rebuking him and correcting him and giving him these prophecies. Jeremiah writes a letter to bring correction, really, to Zedekiah, and he lets his emissaries take the letter. So Jeremiah has access to the throne. I mean, Zedekiah may not be liking what he's saying, but he's still listening to him. Yeah, just, I don't know what to do with that. So, this is the, what was written in the letter. Start with verse 4. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who were carried away captive, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and dwell in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands, so that they may bear sons and daughters. So they were to marry each other within their race, because there was, God was going to bring forth, and he did bring forth. The only ones who could return with Ezra were those who had stayed pure, and they had not had their blood mixed with the Babylonians. So those were the only ones who were allowed to come back with Ezra. So they had to stay within their race, because God had to have a pure people, because out of these people coming in was going to come forth the Messiah, the Son of God, and there had to be a totally pure race for the seed of the Son to come forth. Okay. That you may be increased there and not diminished. Seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive. Seek the peace of the state of Texas. Seek the peace of the city of Houston. Seek the peace of Fort Bend County. And pray to the Lord for it. For in its peace, you will have peace. Glory to God. Okay. So Leonard Ravenhill wrote a very, it's a strong statement. I just picked up bits and pieces from it about the prophet. And it was kind of attached to this chapter. And this is what he's saying about the prophet. Prophet comes to set up that which is upset. Okay? His work is to call into line those who are out of line. He is unpopular because he opposes the popular immorality and spirituality. In a day of faceless politicians and voiceless preachers, now this was written, I guess, 50 years ago. There is no more urgent national need than that we cry to God for a prophet. The function of the prophet, as Austin Sparks once said, has almost always been that of recovery. Remember when we were preaching Isaiah, and God called Isaiah to preach judgment. And then when God brought judgment upon the earth, now he says, Isaiah, change your message. Now I want you to preach comfort to my people. So the prophet has to preach the message that God is saying to preach. If God's moving in judgment, the prophet has to preach judgment. If God is moving in recovery, the prophet has to preach comfort and recovery. Only what God is to me. Gift of prophecy. A gift of prophecy won't go there. I mean, this is the office of prophecy. This is the name of the message today is the prophet. Because we're talking about Jeremiah standing in the office of prophet, and he God used him to kill the false prophets, and as opposed to. Okay, 8-14. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. Do not let your prophets act. Okay, now this is still the letter. Do not let your prophets and your diviners who are in your midst deceive you, nor listen to your dreams which you cause to be dreamed. For they prophesy falsely to you in my name. I have not sent them, says the Lord. For thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word towards you to return to this place. God says, I will perform my good word toward you. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Okay. If that's what God is seeking toward us all the time, then if we are thinking God's thoughts, then we're going to be thinking those same thoughts towards God, toward God's people and toward the earth. We're going to be thinking the same thoughts as God's thoughts if we have the mind of Christ. We're not going to be thinking about fussing it and causing trouble or being in trouble and any of that kind of stuff. Not going to be there. If you will call upon me and find me, if you search for me, all your love.
Turn orange off.
You shall seek me and find me. Just so y'all know, Jesus. This band is trying out for, I don't know what, I guess a job or something, or a gig. They call it a gig, don't they? Yeah, he and his band are trying out this morning for a gig. You shall seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all your heart. And I will be found of you, says the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity. That means your captivity. That means your captivity to love addiction. That means your captivity to anything that you have you captive. God says, "I will turn away your captivity. Anything that is causing you pain in your life." You again into the place where I caused you to be carried away back. And we've seen that happen over and over with the Jewish people. But that word is also for us. It is noteworthy that the priest Ezekiel was also deported in 397 B.C. and was called to the prophetic office it must be 392 BC because I've got 592, sorry. Which would have been 5 years after. Sorry. He confirmed the word of Jeremiah to the exiles and was a second witness to this truth. Guess whose words got in the Holy Bible forever? And is even written in heaven? Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Anan, don't wear around in the Bible. And we've had some of those that people who died and went to heaven, some of those books that we read about people dying and going to heaven. They got it. They said Jeremiah's up there preaching. He's up there preaching in heaven. I said something Sunday morning that I probably haven't heard me say before, that we were standing in Psalm 18 in 2020, November 2020, when I prophesied and declared that word over our church and over the nation and over President Trump, that we were standing in that Psalm 18 and declaring it, and that we have been standing in Psalm 18, and that when I had that vision, the Lord took me into Psalm 18 again, to show me that we have stepped into another realm. So the Lord showed me, and I don't think I've articulated it, but I know it. The Word of God is living. The Word of God is alive. The Word of God is the Word of God. The Word became flesh and it dwelt among us. So the Word of God has been there since from the beginning. We stepped into the Word of God and we actually actually are living in a living word. Does that make sense to y'all?
Yes.
It's not words on a page. We are actually living in that word. And the Lord took me into Psalm 18, which is a living word in heaven continually and forever, to show me where we are.
That's good.
And then he took me into Psalm 35 and showed me where the church is going to. Not Psalm 35, Isaiah 35. That's what I believe. That's what I believe. If you stay in the Word, and I know all of you Word people, y'all probably memorize that Bible backwards and forwards, know it better than me. But I stay in Word for hours and hours and hours preparing these messages before the Lord. I'm not to prepare the message to deliver to y'all. I sure am glad y'all come. That's not what I do. I'm getting in the presence of the Lord and bringing forth His Word. And when you live in the Word like that, you become one with the Word. That word becomes living life. And people, and I said recently, and I said it yesterday, there's been a famine in the land of the hearing of the word. Mm-hmm. Not just the pandemic being closed down and the churches can't hear the word. The people, even if the word comes forth, they don't hear it. Are not hearing that you give a false word intentionally and knowingly, you may die next week. Or you might have an early death. Help me, Jesus. No, Brian. Okay. Leonard Rabbit Hill again. The prophet is God's detective seeking for a lost treasure. He or she has no price tags. I've had people tell me they won't come to this church unless I give them an offering of $3,000. Some of them, I guess now they probably raised their price to $5,000. Okay, I don't bring them. They got a price tag on their gift. They're totally otherworldly. They march to another drummer. Okay, I'm talking about good prophets now. I'm sorry. I changed. I'm talking about the prophets of God are totally otherworldly. Say you're so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. Praise God. Amen. Let me be so heavenly minded that I'm no earthly good, because anything I bring down here, I want to bring it out of heaven. I don't want to bring earth up to heaven. They march to another drummer. They don't hear the drum beat of the cosmos. We don't even understand what they're talking about. They're talking about stuff we really believe they're crazy. This critical race theory, these people have totally lost their mind. God's prophets breathe the rarefied air of inspiration. They are seers who come to lead the blind. What do they see? Not the circumstances of trouble that is around your life, but how God wants to come and bless you. How, with everything that He has, He wants you blessed. He wants you well. He wants you strong. He wants you to be alive. This is what God has for you. They don't see the circumstances of, but they see what God desires for his people. They live in the heights of God and come into the valley with a thus says the Lord. He or she shares some of the foreknowledge of God and so are aware of impending judgment. Now we got in some trouble. Heard a little trouble. I didn't pay no attention. When the pandemic hit, and I said, this is judgment on America. I mean, this is just pure and simple. This is the plague. This is judgment on America, not just America, but the whole earth. Okay, there are people actually walking around who are Christians that don't believe that God would bring judgment on the earth. Mm-hmm. And so they wouldn't come up under that teaching. I'm sorry. I've read the whole Bible. I read the New Testament. It doesn't change. We don't get a pass. We get grace, but we don't get a pass. We get grace for our stupidity. Thank God. Every time I might lose my patience over something, God will remind me of something I did that was stupid. I thought it was under the blood. He or she shares some of the foreknowledge of God and so are aware of impending judgment. Okay, so now the Lord addresses the false prophets, 15 through 20. Now we're talking to the false prophets. Because you have said, the Lord has raised up prophets for us in Babylon, thus says the Lord concerning the king who sits on the throne of David. Concerning all the people who dwell in the city, and concerning your brethren who have not gone with you into captivity, behold, I will send on them the sword, the famine, and the pestilence. I will make them like rotten figs that cannot be eaten. Now I can tell you that the judgment of the sword is upon New York City and upon Los Angeles. They are killing each other. It may not be coming from a foreign country, but it's still the judgment. A war is being on the streets of New York City. I heard him talking on Fox and Friends this morning that there are only small pockets in New York City that you could go into where you feel safe. We see them on television shooting each other. Now y'all listen to this, all of you big people who don't have it figured out these figs yet. I will make them like rotten figs. That cannot be eaten. They are so bad. I will pursue them with the sword, the famine, and with pestilence. I will deliver them to trouble among all the kingdoms of the earth, to be a curse, an astonishment, a hissing, and a reproach among all the nations where I have driven them. Look what Germany did to the Jews. Poland. I can name some other countries. Look what they did to the Jews. This is serious. God is serious when he's saying this. Because they have not heeded my words, says the Lord, which I sent to them by my servants the prophets. If they had repented then and there, all of this would not have come upon the Jewish race. But they could still repent. They could still repent. The minute they turned to Jesus Christ and ask him to forgive their sins, they will come out from under this. Mm-hmm. I sent my prophets rising up early and sending them. neither would you heed, says the Lord. Therefore, hear the word of the Lord, all you of the captivity whom I have sent from Jerusalem to Babylon. We're saying, Judah, don't look to Zedekiah. He's already a dead man. You know, they burned his eyes out and killed his sons right in front of his eyes. Terrible things. The reference to the rotten things refers to the sign given by Jeremiah. The Lord is verifying his former words by the true prophet. God identifies with his servants. If my word of God says if we honor him publicly, he will honor us publicly. If you stand up for Jesus Christ publicly, he's going to stand up for you.
Amen.
Oh, look at Stephen. Look at Stephen. Oh, I just love that story. Stephen stood up for Jesus Christ. And Christ got up from his throne. He stood up from his throne. And he met Stephen and stood up for Stephen.
Amen.
And it is written in the Bible for infinity.
Yes.
Verse 21. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, concerning Ahab the son of Kaliah and Zedekiah the son of Messiah, who prophesy a lie to you. These are two prophets in my name. Prophesy a lie in my name. Serious business. Behold, I will deliver them into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and he shall slay them before your eyes. It is the Lord who's killing a lot of people in these chapters. The Lord says, I'm going to kill these two prophets. And he singles out these two false prophets by name. It's not a lot of things to lie or manipulate in the Lord's name. Back to Larry Rabbit Hill. The prophet eats daily the bread of affliction while he ministers. But he feeds the bread of life to those who listen. He walks before men for days, but he walked before God for years before he ministers before people. You're going to spend a lot of time sitting before the Lord, or I am here. I told Ruby yesterday, someone gave me a word at the beginning of the pandemic that the next, was it 2 years to 3 years, was going to be the strongest of my whole ministry. Of God using me. Okay, what did God call me into warfare? Mm-hmm. And let's see, we got 1 year now, I think, from when I got that prophecy. I don't even remember who gave it to me now. Maloney.
James Maloney.
July of 2019, he said, I figured when it was three years. The next 3 years, he said, will be the strongest of your whole ministry, which is the reason why I've been called for.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but I've been 30 years ministering and preparing. Okay, so God spent those 30 years to prepare me for these 3 years. I did some good, I hope, along the way. Preaching and teaching. But when the time came, he called me forth to begin to prophesy his judgment in the land. He's very thorough. He's very thorough. So we may be in preparation. If you are ambitious or anxious for your ministry to get started, that you think you need bigger and better and more, and whatever. I didn't feel like that. But some do. Maybe you're just in preparation.
Mm-hmm.
If he spent a lot of my lifetime to prepare me for these 3 years, praise God.
Amen.
Praise God. false prophets kept up their fight against Jeremiah, even in Babylon. People's prophets and diviners were encouraging false hopes among the people. But a promise of an early deliverance from the captivity. Now, I will say, I thought when we went through this pandemic that we were going to knock that thing out and we'd be out of there by Easter. I really thought we would. The prophets were saying that, and I thought we would too. But we weren't. No, they were not about to let this thing go. And false it behind it. And some more people inside Trump's inner circle. 22-23. Because of them, a curse shall be taken up by all the captivity of Judah who are in Babylon, saying, the Lord make you like Zedekiah and Ahab, whom the king of Babylon roasted in fire. So they tried to roast the three Hebrew children. And that's what he did. He roasted people in fire. But God had his hand on those three Hebrew children. They were doing what God told him to do, and God delivered them. Because they have done disgraceful things in Israel, have committed adultery with their neighbor's wives, and have spoken lying words in my name, which I have not commanded them. Indeed, I know, and I am a witness, says the Lord. Because of them, a new curse was released. The Lord does not miss anything. He forgives our ignorance and mistakes once we repent. When we willfully lie in his name or move out in his name without him having spoken, just Lord help us all. Lord help me, Jesus. Litter and rabbit hill. A prophet carries the lamp of truth among heretics. He faces God before he faces men. But he is not self-effacing. But he is self-effacing, I'm sorry. He hides with God in the secret place, but he has nothing to hide in the marketplace. That means he is fair and truthful in all of his feelings in the marketplace. He is naturally sensitive, but supernaturally spiritual. He has passion, purpose, and pugnacity. He is ordained of God. I just want you to know, I'll say this now because it was kind of put out not too long ago. People who are ordained in this church, you're ordained of God. You're not ordained by a little Eastgate church that's insignificant in the eyes of man. You see, men, what you want to be ordained under a very nationally recognized ministry. Well, that's fine, and I'm sure God ordained them. But in this little ministry, I don't ordain you unless God speaks to me. I don't care how much I love you and how great I think you are and how much you've been faithful and how much you've worked. I do not ordain people for faithfulness and working hard. I ordain people because God speaks to me.
Amen.
And there has been something in your life that has brought you into a place where God has set his hand up on you and placed you into a particular ministry. And I would say you better be proud of it. And say, God ordained me, not Carolinism that no one's ever heard of, or Eastgate Church that no one has ever heard of.
Amen.
You better stand in that.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm just telling you. Okay, boy, this is 11:50. We'll wind it down. Okay, so now we got the letter from the false prophet. It's not written in red, as you will notice on your notes. 24 through 29. Well, this is Jeremiah speaking to the false prophet. You shall speak to Shemaiah the Nehelamite, saying, thus speaks the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, saying, you have sent letters in your name to all the people who are at Jerusalem, to Zephaniah, the son of Messiah, the priest, and to all the priests, saying, the Lord has made you priest instead of Jehoiada, the priest, so that there shall be officers in the house of the Lord over every man who is demented, and considers himself a prophet, that you should put him in prison and in stocks. Now, therefore, why have you not rebuked Jeremiah of Anathoth, who makes himself a prophet to you? For he has sent to us in Babylon, saying, this captivity is long. Build houses and dwell in them and plant gardens and eat their fruit. Zephaniah the priest read this letter in the hearing of Jeremiah. Shemaiah, I had it right the first time. That was the false prophet. Shemaiah was one of the leading false prophets in Babylon. And he intended that Jeremiah be put in stocks and in the collar. But God regarded Shemaiah's teaching as being rebellion against the Lord by his opposition to truth and influencing others to turn aside from the truth, because he taught rebellion against the Lord. Our life can be revealing God, or we can live a life that shows rebellion against the Lord. His life was brought to an end. It's a serious business for those who lead others in rebellion. When one is a leader of men or women, you can either lead them into rebellion or you can have them lead them to follow God. And you know with your own children, you know those that were born to be leaders, they were just natural leaders. People just naturally followed them because they were born leaders. And you watch them as they grow. They can either lead people into evil, or they can lead people into God.
Amen.
Satan will try to steal that leadership anointing to lead people into evil. Mm-hmm. Here in 29:32 and 28:16, two prophets died the same year that Jeremiah prophesied to them. I know this is rough stuff. This is tough stuff. I mean, after all, we live in our little sheltered worlds, and we go to our air-conditioned homes, and we have food at our grocery stores, and we live in this sheltered world, and we go to church on Sunday, and we worship God. How can this happen? Well, I'm thinking God's getting something real serious. God's getting real serious. Tell me to preach this. The promise of restoration is to all of us in the new covenant. Romans 8:14-23. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. I told them yesterday, I've been coming against fear now for 2 years, which has been trying to take over our nation. But you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Verse 29. Then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, send to all those in captivity, saying, thus says the Lord concerning Shemaiah, because Shemaiah has prophesied to you, and I have not sent him, and he has caused you to trust in a lie. Therefore, thus says the Lord, behold, I will punish Shemaiah and his family. He shall not have anyone to dwell among this people, nor shall he see the good that I will do for my people, says the Lord, because he has taught rebellion against the Lord. Okay, now this false prophecy of this canceled culture is teaching rebellion against the Lord. I declare and prophesy now that those false prophets who are behind this cancel culture, that just as Jeremiah died, that you will die and you will not see the fruition of your false teaching and your false prophecy. Church is going to have to declare it. Where is the authority? Not in our government. It's in the church. And when we pray, prophetic people, you are going to have to pray, and instead of fussing at that thing, we're going to have to declare that it will come up under the judgment of Shemaiah and Hananiah. Because they taught rebellion against the Lord.
Yes.
Is that including
Black Lives Matter? Black Lives Matter and TIFA. Because they taught rebellion against the Lord. Joe Biden. Kamala Harris. Nancy Pelosi. Doug Schumer. Schiff. Nadler. I say it to you, the pundits on television that are lying, I say it to you that you will come up under the judgment of Hananiah and Shemaiah. You will come up under the judgment of Hananiah and Shemaiah because you have taught rebellion against the Lord. And church, I will tell you, preachers, I will tell you, you best get to preaching it, and you best get to declaring it. See why my website's not down. Judgment of Shemaiah is so severe that it affects his children. Thus says the Lord, all of it, I just spoke and prophesied God's word.
Amen.
I didn't add to it and I didn't take away. Jesus, we're going up to high places. What's that song, going up to the high places? Go there, devil's getting back. Does anybody know that word? Kareem, you know that.
Thank you.
tear the devil's kingdom down.
Y'all just do this, whatever y'all do it. Do it, Lord, do it.